evening, everybody. I'm very happy to be here in the name of our team also, because what I will tell you today, the story about the discovery of this amazing planetary system called TRAPPIST-1, is an effort from a whole team, and especially of Michael Gillon, who is the PI and the leader of the exoplanet team in Liège. But it's a full work of a team. And tonight, it's also the perfect time to explain you and give you more information about exoplanets and what are our research for the future and what we expect in the coming years. There is a question that humankind has since a very long time, and it's quite amazing to see that since a few years, astronomers have been making a lot of progress in that direction. Are we alone in the universe? I'm pretty convinced that one day, thanks particularly to astronomers, we might have an answer to this question. That is a very fundamental question, and which is linked to from where are we coming. And first, as a little reminder, remind yourself that we are living on planet Earth, a little rocky planet among the 8 planets of our own solar system. In the center of the solar system is the sun, a star. And the rocky planets are very small compared to the gas giant planet that you can see here, Jupiter, Saturn, of course, as you know very well. And in the last year, we have discovered that the exoplanets, which are planets orbiting other stars than the sun, can be very different from what we know. But we are amazed by our own planet, the blue planet. It's a very special planet. It's the only one that we know to harbor life. And since many years, many astronomers are very interested through a discipline called astrobiology to understand better how life can emerge in the universe. And we believe that from the example we have, our Earth, it probably can happen on terrestrial planet like our own planet. So what makes our planet different from the others in the solar system? Our planet, our blue planet, is full of water. 75% on the surface of the Earth is covered by liquid water. Our planet is a beautiful planet, and each time I give a talk, I remind everybody, please, we should try to protect our planet. Our planet is fantastic. We are born on our planet. It's a beautiful planet, probably the most beautiful we know so far, and it harbors our life. A very complex biosphere with animals, vegetals, and of course human beings. And astronomers are now asking themselves the question, what is needed for a planet to be habitable? Okay, that's one of the views of the habitability of a planet, I think, that I like particularly much. This is just a small illustration to show you also that water, liquid water, is a very precious element on Earth. Look how small it is if you take all the water from all the oceans and you put them in a little sphere compared to our planet. And remind yourself that we believe that life appeared in the ocean on Earth and that our body is made of a lot of water. So water, we believe, is very important for the apparition of life. And water is everywhere in the universe. But we need liquid water, most probably, to at least to the model we have from our Earth for the emergence of life. So if we look at the 4 rocky planets of our solar system, this is the portrait, the family planets, the rocky planet of our solar system. You know them, of course, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. They are all very different. Our planet Earth is the most beautiful, for sure. And why Earth has life on it? It's still a big mystery, of course, how life appeared, how life formed. But as astronomers, we are trying to understand what is particular compared to the other planets. And we have defined a concept which is called the habitable zone. The habitable zone is the zone around the star where, if you have a rocky planet and good condition, you could have liquid water on the surface. You understand very well that if you are too close to the star, it's too warm, too hot, the water will evaporate, and if you are too far, the water will freeze as ice. So in our solar system, if we compute the habitable zone, we see that Venus is just in the inner edge of the habitable zone and is very hot, very warm. And it's a real inferno. It's 500 Celsius on the surface, Water is in the middle of the habitable zone. You know the condition of life on Earth. And Mars is also inside the habitable zone. So why Mars has no life on its surface? Where are the Martians? Some people believe they've seen them, but I'm not convinced at all. And from the pictures, the photos from the spacecraft that are around Mars or on Mars, it looks like Mars has no life. Unfortunately, it would be really cool to have neighbors on Mars, of course. But maybe Mars in the past had an ocean, and maybe life appeared on that ocean, but for a little time. Because unfortunately, it's not good enough just to be in the habitable zone. There are many other conditions to fulfill to be an habitable planet. Mars is too small and has been not able to retain its atmosphere for a long time enough. The atmosphere evaporated, and so today Mars is a dry world. So in our solar system, it looks very difficult to find life. There might be still some places, like under the crust of Europa, a satellite of Jupiter, maybe. But we believe the best is to look to the stars, to search around the stars, to look for other planets around stars. This is what we call the exoplanet, the extrasolar planets. And there is a good news in this, is that, there is a lot of stars in our galaxy. There are about 300 billion suns. It's a lot. It makes us astronomers very happy, because we have many stars to look at to find the planets. This is not our own galaxy, of course. This is a spiral galaxy. We are inside the galaxy, which we call the Milky Way, which was the nice Milky Way, this nice arch, white, that you can see in the beautiful sky without any light pollution, for sure not, unfortunately, from Brussels. 300 billion stars, that's a lot. That's a lot of work for us astronomers. So, since several years now, some astronomers have been focused to study, try to find exoplanets, extrasolar planets, planets around other stars. And the first exoplanet has been discovered by a team of Swiss astronomers, Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz. And the first planet they found is a very strange planet, completely different from what we knew in our, we know in our solar system. They found what we call a hot Jupiter. This planet is a giant gaseous planet, a bit bigger than Jupiter, but very close to its star. It orbits around its star in only 4 days. It's why we call it a hot Jupiter, because you understand, it's a the star is a sun-like star, like our sun, but it does not orbit at 10 years, on an orbit of 10 years like our own Jupiter, but on a 4 days orbit. So, of course, the star is very hot. The planet is very hot. So now, our astronomers, and I will explain just some basic of the methods we are using to detect exoplanets. Our astronomers, what techniques are they using, are we using to detect exoplanets? So here a little illustration. You could see a planet as a little firefly that is shining because it's in fact reflecting the light of the sun. It orbits around. And here it's host star. So you see directly that the planet, you cannot see it because the planet is lost. The light of the planet is lost in the glare of the star. So again, a planet would be like a little firefly just close to a very bright lighthouse. So astronomers to be very smart to be able to find the exoplanet. It's a very tough job. It's really difficult work. And the first exoplanet you have to imagine has only been discovered 20 years ago. I was born well before that, where we had no exoplanet, and one day, wow, the astronomer found the first exoplanet. There are several techniques, and of course you could think the easiest is just to take a photo of the exoplanet. Sure, why not? Well, again, a lighthouse and the little fireflies. So it's really extremely difficult. So one idea for the what we call the direct imaging is to take direct photo of an exoplanet. And for that, we use the biggest telescope in the world. They have about 10 meter diameter. They are big machines, about 500 tons, big mirrors to look with a high resolution on stars. And we block the light of the star with a little disc dark disk here you see, so we can observe and take a photo of planets around the star. This has been done for a few systems, but they are very rare. They are for very young planets, very warm planets, and far from their stars, not at all Earth-like planets. So we can do it, but only for little, a very small number of systems. There is another method, which is the one used by the Swiss astronomers, which is called the radial velocity method technique. In fact, you all know very well that the sun attracts the planets because of the gravitational force. But in fact, the planet also attracts the sun, the star. But as the planet has a very small mass, this attraction is very small. But this can be measured with extremely precise spectrometer, and the Swiss, as you know, are extremely good to make very precise machines. And so there is a wobble of the star due to the fact that there is a planet turning around. It produces what we call as physicists a Doppler shift. So it's a shift to the blue if the star comes closer to the Earth, shift to the blue when the star is getting closer to the Earth, and a shift to the red of the spectrum when the star goes away due to the movement orbit of the planet around the star. But this, with very sensitive instrumentation, we can measure, and it's amazing, we can measure a star like a sun that moves around its point of gravity, center point of gravity, moves by just a few centimeters. We can do that now. This is a very interesting technique because you can use it for all the stars in the sky. You don't need a special configuration. You can get the mass of the star, the orbit, the period, you can get, sorry, the mass of the planet, the orbit of the planet, but you don't get the size of the planet. You have no idea of the size of the planet. That's a problem. A very powerful technique, that's the last one I will show you. There are others. A very powerful technique is the transit method. This is the one we are using in Liège. This is the one that has been the most productive in the last years. I will show you that. And the idea is very simple, and it happens in our own solar system. Sometimes you have one of the inner planets, Mercury or Venus, passing just in front of the sun. So this is the Venus transit in 2012. You see an image of the sun, and it's a composite image where you can see Venus just passing in front of the sun. So we stacked several images to see that. And you see that the light of the sun is blocked by the planet because the planet is not transparent, right? So it blocks the light of the star. And this is the idea that astronomers have had to survey a lot of stars to see if some are showing a little dip of the brightness due to the fact that a planet is passing in front of the star. This is the transit technique. So, just to give you a bit of an idea how it works, with a telescope we observe a star, for instance, and we look the flux of the star through the night, and we take images, many, many images, and nothing happened, but if a planet is passing just in front of the star, of course it needs to be aligned with the Earth, right? Because if this is above, the planet is passing there or passing there, you will not see any dimming of the star. But if it's just passing in between us and the star, you will see a dimming of the light of the star, like this, and then it comes back to normal. That can be the sign of a planet passing in front of the star. If you reobserve the phenomenon around the same star several times, you can then compute the time it takes to orbit the star. Then you have the period. Then you can get from some law of Kepler, you can get the distance of the planet to the star. This is a very powerful technique because it gives you the orbit of the planet around the star. It gives you the diameter, of course, because you understand very well by this little graphic, if the planet is really big, it will block a bigger part of the star, right? If this is a small planet, the dip here will be smaller because the light of the star will be less hidden by the planet. So we have a possibility, a mean, to get the size of the planet. We can also probe the atmosphere because if you have an atmosphere around the planet, the light from the star is crossing the atmosphere of the planet. And from Earth, you could see a change of the light of the star because it might be absorbed by the atmosphere of the planet. So it's super powerful. And if you are lucky, like for TRAPPIST-1, of course, you can even get the masses of the planet. Because sometimes the planet can interact between themselves, okay? And they will, the timing of the transit, the timing, the time when the planet will pass in front of the star, will change because there is interaction between the planets. So thanks to all that, you can get a full characterization of your system and of your planets. So it's a very powerful technique. But there is always something to pay. You have to be lucky enough for the planet just to pass in between the Earth and the star. You need to be a bit lucky. But there are many, many stars in the galaxy, 300 billion. So you survey 100,000 of them, and you can be lucky enough, statistically, you will have a chance to catch some events like that. And indeed, since about 10 years, there are now many surveys, transit surveys, as we call them, of telescopes on the Earth, on the ground, in space also, that are monitoring the flux of hundreds of thousands of stars during months to try to catch the passage, the transit of a planet in front of the star. One of the most famous is the Kepler-NASA mission that was launched about 5 years ago, in space, and that has discovered the biggest number of exoplanets. Indeed, last year they announced, again, they released more than 1,200 planets discovered by this telescope staring on the same fields for months, and then able to detect planets passing and passing again in front of the host star. So today, this graphic is showing the number of exoplanets discovered within the years. So the first one in 95. And you see, in the last few years, there's been many more detections thanks to this Kepler satellite, NASA Kepler satellite. We are close to 3,500 exoplanets discovered today. And thanks to the transit, you can have an idea of the size of the planet. And, oops, it did not show up here. Voilà. No. Voilà, sorry. Here, a little histogram showing that this is the size of the planet, so you go here to bigger planets like the giant, and here you go to small planets like the Earth. And you see from, this is the number of planets discovered, you see that thanks to Kepler, for instance, that there is more little planets than big planets. It's a good news, because little planets are most probably rocky planets. There is also now a very famous survey telescope, it's called TRAPPIST. Yeah, it's Belgian, it's from Liège. And it's called, so this is my colleague, Michael Gillon, who make his brain work very hard for months to get the name. Well, he had just to see me drinking some beer and he got it. So it's TRAPPIST, for Transiting Planets and Planetesimal Small Telescope. Yeah. So he's doing exoplanet, this is his field of research, I'm doing comets. Yeah, but I like also to talk about exoplanets. So it's why I'm here tonight. So it means petit télescope pour l'observation des planètes en transit, now you are expert, and planetesimals. Planetesimals, I'm not talking about them today, I would like, but I have not enough time. It's asteroids and comets. Very important to understand the formation of our solar system, because the planets are formed from little bodies in the origin of the solar system, comets, asteroids. I stop here, I'll never stop. And, of course, the beers, you understood. And, surprisingly, when we go to conferences now everywhere in the world, when we talk about TRAPPIST, everybody knows the best beer in the world are TRAPPIST from Belgium. This is good. So it's easy to be identified as from the little Belgium with very good beer and chocolate. And this is when we finish the installation of TRAPPIST South, this nice telescope in the Atacama Desert. With Michael Gillon, my colleague, we could find some nice TRAPPIST beer in Santiago downtown in a bar at 1 o'clock in the morning. I prefer not to tell you the price of the little bottle, but it was very tasty. TRAPPIST is located in one of the best places in the world to look at the sky, in the Atacama Desert in Chile. It's a very dry place, one of the driest places in the world. The average humidity is about 5 to 10% there. it's really dry, you have to drink a lot, not Trappist water. And the sky is beautiful, of course. This is La Silla Observatory from the South European Southern Observatory. And as you can see the landscape, we are at about 2,500 meters. The sky is beautiful, fantastic, 300 clear nights per year. It's a dream for the astronomers. We call all that region in Chile the Photon Valley, like Silicon Valley, but us astronomers, we are interested by photons. This is what we collect with our telescopes. So there are many, many telescopes, but the most important telescope there, of course, is TRAPPIST. It's there. It's a very little, tiny telescope, very cheap, and but it has been paid by our FNRS, so we are very proud of it, and it made a really great discovery, as you know. It is in a strategic point in the observatory, by the way. It's just close to the room. I can even hear the telescope from my bed in the night, and it's very close to the kitchen. The sky, as I say, is just fantastic there. I mean, it's unbelievable. I mean, you need to go in the Sahara or in the Atacama Desert in Chile with a night without moon. If you go with the full moon, so look the calendar with the moon, so you can maybe see, you will see, the Milky Way. Because it's 300 clear nights per year. 300, not 30 like in Belgium. 300. Of course, this is fantastic for us. So now I would like to explain you why we are talking about the TRAPPIST planets and why we made this discovery with a very small telescope, with astronomers in Belgium and so on, with a 60-centimeter telescope, while the biggest telescope in the world are 10 meters. You have telescope in space that are billions of dollars. Our telescope is not much. It's because, of course, it what matters are the IDs. And Michael Gillon, my colleague, had really a great idea. A really great idea. Everybody was focused to find the exoplanet around sun-like stars, stars like our sun. But he had the idea, why not look to other kind of stars, and especially the small, tiny, ultra-cool red dwarfs. So I will explain what they are, but you will understand rapidly why it was really a great idea. So here, that's the sun. That's an image of the sun. And maybe you see it, but the Earth is passing in front of it. Do you see it? Just right in the middle. You see, you can put 110 times the Earth along the diameter of the sun. So it's very tiny compared to the surface of the sun. But if you are searching for an Earth-sized planet around a little tiny star, like the ultra-cool red dwarfs, like this one, which are about 10 times smaller than the sun, relatively, the fraction of the surface of the star that is hidden by the planet passing in front of it will be bigger, right? Here, you will, the fraction of the surface of the star hidden by the Earth planet will be bigger than, of course, in front of the sun. So you have a signal, a signature, a dip, which is much easier to detect. And then you don't need a 1 billion telescope in space, but just a small telescope on Earth. In fact, you really get 100 times more signal for your planet in front of little stars. You don't have money, so you have to have IDs. So ultra-cool dwarf stars, what they are? They are the less massive stars in the galaxy. They weigh only 10% of the mass of the sun. They are only 10% of the size of the sun. They are very cold. Everybody laughs when I say that because it's 2,500 degrees. Still, it's very cold for a star. These are the coolest stars. They are really cool also and cold, and they are very nice little stars. Nobody cared before. And they are too different from the sun. They are too active. They are too strange, too cold, too blah, blah. But in fact, they are maybe one of the most interesting and obviously forming planets, which is great. And something very interesting also, they live forever. The sun has an espérance de vie of 1,000 billion years. Sorry, the sun, 10 billion years. It is born 4.7 billion years ago. It has still about 5 billion years to go, so no problem. But a little red ultra-cool star has an espérance de vie of 1,000 billion years. Sorry, very long time to develop life, of course, on its surface. The age of the universe is not that big. The age of the universe, by the way, is 15 billion years. The sun is about 5 billion years old, as well as all the planets around it. Something very interesting also is those stars are among the most numerous in the galaxy. There is a lot of them. There are a lot of them, and a lot in the solar neighborhood around us, which is cool, because, of course, if you want to detect and have more information about the planet, it's better that they are close to Earth, right? It's easier to catch them and to analyze them than if they are very far. And the habitable zone around those stars, you will ask. It's also extremely interesting. Why? Because here you have the sun, 6,000 degrees around the sun, the habitable zone, you know, the Earth, we are right in the middle of it, okay? The Earth takes 1 year to make a turn around the sun. The habitable zone around an ultra-cool red star is only about 10 days. So it's much more easy to catch. If you look at a sun-like star, you have to wait about a year to see your habitable planet to pass in front of its sun. The planets around ultra-cool stars in the habitable zone, they only take 10 days. So you just need to wait 10 more days to see it passing again. It's much more easy, and in a year, you have many more transits than just once, like if you look for an Earth around a sun-like star. So they are extremely cool, extremely interesting, and this allowed us, after 6 years of intense research with the TRAPPIST telescope in Chile, to discover this fantastic system that I will present now, that is called TRAPPIST-1, because it's the first planetary system discovered by the TRAPPIST telescope. So we did a first publication, Nature. So Nature is the journal the where every scientist wants to publish because it's the best ranked journal, and it has a big impact because there are many science in it about different topics. And so, of course, we were very happy to announce the discovery in May 2016 of the first three planets around TRAPPIST-1. But that was not the end of the first three terrestrial planets. It's very important to say these are terrestrial planets. They have about the size of the Earth and about the mass of the Earth. I will come back to this. And they've been discovered around this very strange little cool star, which is TRAPPIST-1. And TRAPPIST-1 is not very far. It's about 39 light years away. It's one of the closest stars to the sun, in fact. It's about 300 in the ranking, while there are 300 billion stars in the galaxy. And the galaxy has a diameter of 100,000 light years. 100,000 light years. And here we are just close to it, 39 light years, that star. Very interesting. Here it's a comparison between TRAPPIST star, ultra-cool stars, and Jupiter. They have about the same size, but TRAPPIST-1 is 80 times more massive than Jupiter. It's really a star. So what is a star? A star is a body in the universe or in a galaxy, a big sphere of gas, helium, and hydrogen mostly, that produce its own light, its own energy, thanks to nuclear reaction, fusion reaction inside a star. Jupiter is cold. It's far from the sun and does not emit its proper light from fusion inside. So this is the difference between a star and a planet. In 2016, when we discovered those three first planets, of course, we were extremely excited. We tried to keep this secret as long as we could, then publish the first three planets, and then, of course, start a big campaign with many telescopes on Earth to try to find more planets in the system. Because three planets, why not more? And indeed, for a year, we started to get more and more transits with our different telescopes, like TRAPPIST-Nord that we built in Morocco last year, our TRAPPIST in Chile, and then UKIRT in Hawaii. It's a big 4-meter telescope in Hawaii, the VLT 8-meter telescope, to confirm some of the planets. But the situation was becoming very complicated, and I remember very well my colleague, Michael Gillon, calling me in his office, "Look, it seems we have one more." I say, "No, it's not possible. One more, we have 4, 5, how many there are?" And we were getting more transit, but of course, the planets are passing again and again in front of the star, and you have to be able to identify them. Is it that one or that one? Because they have different periods, they have also a little bit different sizes, and they are at different distances from the planet, so they take more time to turn around. The problem from the ground, from the Earth, for astronomers, it's a big problem. It's not night 24 hours on 24. It's only at most 12 hours, which is really not enough for us. So we need to have telescope all over the world to be always looking the planet, the star TROPPIST-1, when it is nighttime. It's difficult because you have nighttime, daytime from a given site, and it was easy to not be able to identify the planet. So Michael did a proposal, asked for observing time with the Spitzer infrared telescope, and they gave us a lot of time. So I put this because really for a few months it was, oh, what's going on in the system, how many planets? And NASA gave us 500 hours of continuous time on TROPPIST-1. So for about 20 days, 20 times 24 hours, continuously from space with this infrared telescope, with no day-night cycle, we could follow, observe the star, and detect. So it's now you are specialist, right, of light curves of exoplanets. So this is a very long light curve. All the little dots is a measurement of the flux of TROPPIST-1 star. And the dots going down, it's when a planet is passing in front because it blocks the light of the star. And we could identify 34 transits in 21 days. We could clearly identify in total 7 planets and crack the system, as we like to say. You have the one close to the closest, the B planet, which of course turns much faster, only in 2 days around, and the one which is the farthest away, H planet, in about 18 days to make a full orbit. So this system is just fantastic. It's TROPPIST, of course, TROPPIST-1. It's 7 Earth-sized planets, nearly the size of the Earth. Here you have a comparison of our 7 planets compared to the 4 rocky planets of the solar system. They are all rocky. Okay, 3 of them are located inside the famous habitable zone, which does not mean they are inhabited. It just means they could be liquid water if there is good condition of the planet, an atmosphere and so on, good pressure to have the water liquid on the surface. It's still an amazing system, but the comparison with Earth-like planet stops there, because they have the same size, about the same mass, but we don't know much more about them. We are trying now to characterize them more. What we know, which is very different from our own solar system, is that this system is super compact. Look, the 7 planets are all inside the orbit of Mercury. So this is our own solar system. The Earth is here, the Sun would be in the center, and the TROPPIST system, the 7 planets, are compact and inside the orbit of Mercury. Also, the view from TROPPIST-1 planet, any of them, would be very different from what we have from Earth. The Sun from there is very red in the sky, gives orange-pink color in the sky, most probably. Here, it's a case where we would have a planet, what we hope for, with some liquid water on the surface. What would be very interesting also is you see the diameter of the planet in the sky. From Earth, when you look Jupiter or Saturn, they just look like pontsours in the sky. From TROPPIST-1 planet, looking to the other planet, you would see them a bit like the moon, basically, hopefully with some clouds. We hope that they have some atmosphere and maybe water. You could see the continents, if they have continents, because they are close enough to each other. Something also that we believe is that those planets are tidally locked with the star. It's a term a bit complicated, which means that because of the gravitational forces, because the planets are so close to the star, that there's been a synchronization between the rotation of the planet, okay, and its revolution around the star. It's the same period. So the planet is always showing the same face to its star, which means that we have probably a side which is very warm, hot, maybe burnt, and a side which is much more colder. And you can imagine, of course, in the twilight zone, for the fans, the twilight zone, you can have maybe some very interesting situation. And here, this is how NASA is powerful and strong to make advertisement. When we communicated to them this, the discovery, a big machine started, and for 2 months they produce amazing drawings, amazing pictures, amazing ideas. One of these is here. It's planet hopping from TROPPIST-1e, which we believe is the best one to go for vacations. It's really made by NASA GPL Planet Bureau. You have a few people who are working on a kind of a travel agency to advertise the exoplanets, and it's a way to help people to understand how special are the planets we discover. And in this case, this is a real view you could have if you are in a spacecraft going to TROPPIST-1e. I remember, if you don't know yet well our system, E is this one, is one of the smallest in the habitable zone. And if you are there, we hope there is water, of course, maybe of some ice, but you can see the other planets like this. This is a real configuration that you can really have from TROPPIST-1e. So you would see crescent because TROPPIST-1 star is to the right. And you see, if you are a fan of astronomy, you can recognize the Orion constellation here with the belt, the three stars here. You can see, because we are dreamers, you can see a bit of light from maybe a civilization on this planet. And here you have a base, of course, because if you go in vacation there, you still need a bit of, advertisement. And we wanted also to put a piece of Liège there. If there are people living in Liège here, maybe they will recognize something. And in fact, the red dome here is the new Calatrava train station in Liège. So they accepted to put it on the planet. Yeah, we were very happy. It's a bit small, but you can still recognize it. Well, the real people living in Liège, they saw the Perron of Liège here in the middle, but it was a bit too big to be the Perron on the planet. So we did the cover of Nature, which is really great, with this discovery. And indeed, the impact of the discovery has been amazing. We knew we had found something really nice, but we did not imagine the people would really like the story, would really like so much our planet. So this is a great day we had with Michael. You see how happy he is. Huh? And with Julien DeWitt also, he was a student of Michael, now he's working in Boston. He's a specialist of the atmosphere of exoplanets. And this is the 22 of February. My birthday was 21 of February, so I let you imagine the night before. It was pretty amazing. We found a Belgian bar in Washington where we could try Trappist beer, but you could only order one Trappist beer per table. No, it was not possible. We called the chef and we explained them we discovered planets. Seven. I can tell you, okay. So we visited also the Trump Tower. We tried to get an appointment there to get some funds, but no, it didn't work. And this is the bar. It's very in the dark, and I think it's better. It's very in the dark. So in the morning, when we woke up and read in the newspaper in the hotel, it was everywhere. The news was everywhere. The New York Times, New York Post want to get away. And it's CNN came twice in Liège also. It was really fun. And of course, it's very good for science, and it's very good for astronomy, and it's very good for Belgium astronomers to have such a view in the world, really everywhere. We spent 3 days replying, answering to a journalist, I say 3 full days, and receiving a TV and so on and so on. And still today, we are continuing to explain our discovery, because I think it's great, again, for science and motivate young people also to come with us, because we are looking for very nice, bright, motivated students to work with us. We have a lot of data for them. And it made the buzz. The Google Doodle was just amazing. We didn't know, so someone from NASA had contacted Google, and you know, on Google, sometimes for big events, you have something. And it's a great one. You have the Earth trying to find a twin. Oh, there is something there. Poop, 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 poop. Cuckoo. Many, many. So they say, oh, is it possible? Oops, yes, way. Donc, everybody super happy. I think it's really fun. We were in another Belgian bar in Washington that night. There are good bars there. So everywhere on the web, in the days following, in the week following, we have seen many, many interesting things. Really, really, everybody wanted to comment about the discovery, also politics stuff, a bit more from Liège, this. Also planets in the form of bottles. And you know, but really from everything, and if you still don't get it about the ultra cool dwarf star, I hope now you get it. But it's just a sample. I mean, there are really tons of these things. And because we are here also and to listen to a band after, we have been contacted by a lot of artists, painters, singers, and here in Liège for a conference, a famous artist gave us a drawing. He's the person, sorry, I'm very bad to remember names, but he did the little statue that is on the moon, gave to an Apollo mission, and that has been put on the moon. Cartoons, and even a lot of songs, and I really have to show you that for a bit, because it's just amazing. And it has been seen something like 300,000 times. Sorry, it's not displayed, but it's a rap from a Spanish guy. So you don't have the image, I have it, I'm sorry, but so you can find on the web a lot of stories about Trappists, so showing really that the people have been really interested by the discovery. And for us, it's also very exciting times, because in the years coming, there will be really huge telescope on Earth, on the size of 30 to 40 meters of diameter, as well as in space, that will allow us to go further in our study, because what we would like to know now, are those planets habitable? And the first step is to detect their atmosphere. Do these planets have an atmosphere that would allow to have liquid water on their surface? And one of the telescopes especially will be interesting is the James Webb Space Telescope. It's a 6.5-meter infrared telescope. It will be launched in space normally next year, but we hear that maybe it will be delayed by 7 more months. It's a monster, 6.5-meter in space. And thanks to this telescope, we will be able to analyze the atmosphere of the TRAPPIST-1 atmospheres. And we will try to detect what we call the biosignature, try to detect the atmosphere and try to detect elements, molecules in the atmosphere that could tell us that there might be life on the surface. For instance, if you find a cocktail of water, ozone, methane, there is, it seems, a good chance that there might be some biological activity on the surface of the planet. We will not be able to see if there is life on the planet, but by studying the atmosphere of the planet, we should be able, and it has been proven by a paper recently published, that by observing many transits of some of the TRAPPIST planets, like the one in the habitable zone, accumulating the data to increase the signal to noise, as we say, we should be able to detect those biosignatures. And indeed, if from space you look Venus, Mars, or the Earth, you see very different spectra. So a spectrum is when you spread the light, you decompose the light like a rainbow, and you look for the details in that light. And you can see absorption due to some molecule in the atmosphere of Venus, mostly CO2, and in Mars also, while on Earth you see ozone. Of course, it's coming from oxygen, and you see the water, because we have a lot of water on Earth. So this is our big hope, is that maybe in a year or 2 years, thanks to the James Webb Space Telescope, we will be able to detect atmosphere around those our planets, and maybe even detect biosignature. That would be fantastic, of course, and that would be maybe the first evidence of life somewhere else. There are seven, That's our new nice project. It's again an idea of Michael. He's really good for that. I eat them, I drink, and he just watched me drinking, eating, and okay. Speculoos. Speculoos search for habitable planets eclipsing ultra cool stars. So it's exactly what we did with TRAPPIST. So it's, but this time much more systematically and with much more bigger telescopes. So we got 2 million from the European Research Council, a grant. And we people join us in this venture because it's of course extremely interesting, Cambridge and Jeddah University. And now we are in fact installing a nice big telescope. This is what I like the most. Going there in the Atacama Desert to install the telescopes. It's 6 months we have been installing these 4 telescopes. Here is Europa telescope, and you see in the background Paranal Observatory with the VLT. Here are our nice telescope in daytime with the beautiful, perfect blue sky. And in nighttime, there is a bit too much light, but you see the domes and you see the fantastic Milky Way. It's 310 clear nights per year, super dry, 5% humidity, the best place in the world to look and try to find these new exoplanets. Because we found TRAPPIST-1, but we want to do more. We want to survey the 1,000 closest ultra-cool stars around the sun. That will take us 10 years with our 4 telescopes, looking for 10 nights in a row, a given star per telescope, and going on and going on and going on. And statistically, we should again find a new system. This is Io. This is a really beautiful telescope. We took this picture in June because, of course, when we are astronomers, it's also for the beauty of the sky. And I cannot resist to show you to finish my presentation. This beautiful image again of the Milky Way, as well as the first light we did with Europa telescope. The first telescope, so this is a spiral galaxy. There you see with your eyes there is about 200 billion stars in that galaxy. It's millions light years away from our galaxy, so it's not even our own galaxy. You have to imagine that in the universe, we have millions and billions of other galaxies, which each of them have hundreds of billions of stars. That's a lot of places to look for the exoplanets, right? And maybe the hope that there is life somewhere else in the universe. This is a dying star. Very beautiful color. This is also a huge, really huge galaxy that you see this time edge on. So you see the dust in the arms of the galaxy. And this is a beautiful nebula. The nebula are very important. This is where the stars are formed. So this is a group of stars that have been formed in this nebula. And of course, this is around the star that we form the planets. And if more than 20 years ago, it was not clear how planet formed, today, it's just amazing that 20 years after the first discovery of the first exoplanet, we believe that most of the stars make planets, because making planets is just normal in the formation of a star. Then that we might have hundreds of billions of planets in the universe, of course, and in our galaxy also, billions of planets, and maybe some in the habitable zone, and that have conditions to sustain life. And I will finish my presentation with this, and I listen to your questions. Thank you very much.